Muchas gracias. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Mr. Foreign Minister, César, it's wonderful to be with you and wonderful to get a lot of good work done today. I think that work reinforces the way that we can draw on the long-standing partnership between Peru and the United States, bilaterally, but also together with fellow democracies across our hemisphere, to make tangible progress on the issues that actually have an impact on the lives of our citizens. And I think you can see that in all that we actually covered today and accomplished today. The Foreign Minister and I convened fellow ministers for a meeting of the, it's a long name, the Summit Implementation Review Group. What this is a group to follow up on the commitments that we made at the Ninth Summit of the Americas in Los Angeles a few months ago. There, our leaders made commitments to strengthen public health systems, to advance a region-wide digital transformation, to accelerate the clean energy transition, to invest in climate resilience and adaptation, and to promote and protect democratic governance. Today, we agreed to a work plan to start achieving those goals. In fact, we've already gotten to work on this since the Summit of the Americas, and we discussed some of the progress that we've made even over the last 4 months toward realizing our commitments, such as partnering with the Pan American Health Organization to train 500,000 healthcare workers for our hemisphere over the next 5 years, implementing our partnership with Caribbean nations to develop solutions on climate, on energy, on food security through PAC 2030, and investing in Latin American and Caribbean Network for Democracy to support deepened engagement with civil society. César and I also convened another ministerial meeting of the 21 signatories of the Los Angeles Declaration on Migration and Protection. That affirms, for the first time, our shared responsibility in this hemisphere in working to create the conditions for safe, orderly, humane, and regular migration, an issue where Peru is leading by example. At the meeting, we launched a collective implementation process, with countries stepping up to lead across important lines of effort, from finding ways to better integrate migrants and support their host communities to combating xenophobia. Today, I announced on the part of the United States that we'll provide more than $240 million in new humanitarian assistance to meet the needs of refugees and migrants in our hemisphere, as well as the host communities that welcome them. Just since last month, the Department of State and the U.S. Agency for International Development announced nearly $817 million in new assistance supporting our efforts under the Los Angeles Declaration. And of course, as César said, we took part in the first in-person General Assembly of the Organization of American States since 2019. We're grateful for Peru's leadership in hosting what was, I think, a constructive and consequential meeting of the OAS. If you think about it, just in the time since the last OAS General Assembly in person in 2019, we have faced, as a region, as a hemisphere, no shortage of challenges, including COVID-19 and also its lasting human and economic consequences. And more recently, rising food, fertilizer, and energy costs, all of which have been exacerbated by Russia's aggression against Ukraine. The impact of on food supplies and fertilizer in particular has been felt profoundly here in Peru. And President Castillo and I discussed steps that we can take to respond to that challenge. And we committed to working on this together in the months ahead. As we've seen in Peru, in the United States, across our hemisphere, these headwinds are hitting underserved and marginalized communities the hardest, those who can least afford it. That's why the Lima Declaration that we and the OAS member states will adopt tomorrow to work together to advance equity and inclusion across our hemisphere is so important. Being together again gave us the opportunity also to recommit to the region's shared democratic values and to the proposition that we can deliver more for one another and for our people when we actually work together in common cause. It's especially meaningful to make that commitment here in Lima, where our nations came together to adopt the Inter-American Democratic Charter a little over two decades ago, a step that was inspired by the grassroots mobilization of citizens across Peru at the time to defend their democracy and their right to choose their own path. Across all of the issues where we're working regionally to deliver results for our people, Peru and the United States are also working together bilaterally, grounded in our shared interests and values, as we have across many administrations over many years. That shared commitment was crystal clear when the foreign minister and I met with President Castillo today. And we're fortunate, I must say, to have in place a terrific ambassador, Ambassador Kenna, who's been a longtime friend of mine, who is driving our bilateral cooperation across the board. We discussed our shared work on migration. I had the chance to commend the president and the foreign minister for hosting more than 1.3 million Venezuelan refugees and migrants and offering them a pathway to secure a more regular status. Nearly 500,000 Venezuelans have already gone through this process, allowing them to work, to go to school, to access health care, and many other public services that allow them to provide for their loved ones, to build better lives, to contribute to their host communities. Our countries are close partners on environmental challenges as well. Earlier this year, we came together to respond to the ecological devastation that was caused by the oil spill just north of here. Over the last 3 years, USAID has partnered with the Peruvian people and their governments and provided $60 million to improve mining practices, to fight deforestation, to promote sustainable economic development, including in indigenous communities. We continue to work with Peru to address collective threats like transnational crime and drug trafficking, both of which are exacerbated by the scourge of corruption. Our funding, our training, our partnerships have helped Peru make important progress. We'll continue to work together in the years ahead. Tomorrow, I'll have a chance to visit the Chirios Fish Market to highlight our partnership to combat illegal, unregulated, and unreported fishing, which is inflicting significant harm on Peru's marine economy and environment. It's going directly to the livelihoods of Peruvians who are in the fishing business. We also committed to protecting Peru's awe-inspiring culture and heritage. For the last 25 years, we worked together to return more than 2,000 Peruvian cultural artifacts that were once illegally trafficked in the United States. Finally, let me say this. For all the ties that bind our countries, none run as deep as the ties between our people. There are more than 500,000 Peruvian Americans living in the United States. For generations, they've enriched the fabric of our country and our communities, including individuals like the legendary Peruvian American singer Ima Sumac, who is the subject of a mural commissioned at the United States Embassy here in Lima to celebrate the 100th anniversary of her birth, a mural I'm very much looking forward to getting a chance to see tomorrow. So, I apologize for going on so long, but I think that's just evidence that we've had a very productive day, both with our OAS colleagues and bilaterally between the United States and Peru. We and our partners continue to demonstrate real progress on the challenges that matter most in the lives of our people, and we're going to build on that progress in the weeks and months ahead. Thank you very much.